Let's talk a little bit more how the constructors work and how we actually initialize members. Therefore, there exists a construct called member initializer list. So when you construct an object, we know that all members, they get initialized. The question is, how can we call base class constructors? We saw here that we can actually do it by calling a parent constructor in our own constructor. But there are cases in which this slightly differs. It has to be done in a different way. Particularly when we have to initialize members that are constant or that are references. Initialization lists now are actually there to resolve those issues, and they additionally increase performance. So how do they work? Well, you have to specify the member initializers in the definition of the constructor. So when we define the constructor here, this is the function for the constructor. In the implementation, we add a semicolon, and then we provide a list that could be a call like this one for the parent constructors, or it can be members that we initialize that works only for elements of the current class. So in this case, we call a parent constructor here as part of the construction, and then we change iSlices to be 12. Note that we cannot change iSlices here by saying comma iSlices equals 12 here. That doesn't work. The reason is because iSlices is part of cake and not part of long cake. Yeah. However, if we go back to the declaration of cake, yeah, it would have been possible in our implementation of cake constructor to say here colon bplate equals true, then comma iSlices equals 8. So the body here would basically be empty. Okay, so that would then be an initializer list for the implementation of the cake constructor. I hope you can imagine, yeah, this is very, I'd say, very simple and very basic. So when we create now an object from a derived class, we have to have an order in which the constructors are called. It means in our case, the basic class needs to be constructed first and its members need to be initialized. So that means the constructor of a basic class is always executed first before we instantiate and execute the child class. Then after we've done it, the derived object is of course created, calling the constructor of the derived object. And for destructors, we reverse this order. As this can be sometimes a bit tricky to comprehend, here is a little task for you to resolve that illustrates this issue. So what we have here, we have a class test1 that prints in the constructor the message c test1, which stands for constructor test1. And then we have a class test2 that inherits from test1, and in test2 it calls the test1 constructor, and in the body it prints then of this constructor c test2. So here is now the main method that creates a test2 object, and either here we create it on the stack, the local variable, and here we create it on the heap using new. And now think about what this actually prints. And I will reveal the answer in a second. So 3, 2, 1. Hope you have paused the video. Here is now the resolution. What it prints is it prints test 1 and then test 2, of course, because a test 2 object is a test 1 object. Yeah, so class test 2 inherits from test 1, and it calls the constructor of the base class first. So in this case, the base class is test 1. Test 1 doesn't have any further base class, and that's why the first message that we see is ctest1. Afterwards, we execute the body of the test2 constructor, which is ctest2. And it, of course, we see the same messages when we create it on the heap using our new keyword. In terms of destructors, we can have a look how that works. So we have our constructor here, and here we have our destructor. We prefix it in the message with d, and we have the same for test2. So here is a slightly changed test function now. In that sense, it's changed that we call delete, the delete function here on our T2P object that we created on the heap before, which kind of reverses this behavior. Now you could think again about it, what it likely prints, and you have to think about the lifetime of the objects. Yeah, how long does the variable T2 live? When is it, should it be destructed? Should it be destructed here in the next line? Should it be destructed over here and here, here, and here? When is it destructed? Think about it for a moment. The answer is T2 should be destructed when you leave the scope of the variable T2, as it was on the stack. Whenever we leave the function, we should, of course, destroy T2. Yeah, here is user managed test 2 when we instantiate it here with the new operator. We create it, but we delete it. So we should see the constructor message from test 2 here. Then we see the constructor here again for this object. Then the destructive of this object. And lastly, the destructor of T2 over here. Let's have a look. So we of course construct test 1 object, then the test 2 object. Then we call the new operator test 1, test 2. Now we free the object with delete. Of course, we destroy it. Test 2 first, then test 1. And then we leave the scope of the object here, the function, destroying the object T2 over here, like I said. And that frees the memory. So to wrap up today's lecture, what is the constructor? It's a method that initializes the members of an object. The destructor is a method that frees memory. With inheritance, we form hierarchies of similar objects that allows us to reuse data and code. Protected members can be accessed by child classes. Private members, they can only be accessed by the methods of the respective class. So we should not use inheritance to differentiate values. So we should not have a green and a red car, for example, as a child class, because these are just different instances of the same class that have a slightly different data value. But semantically, they are the same. Just the data is different. So inheritance is very powerful, but you should not overdo it. Maybe you shouldn't have a too deep hierarchy. It shouldn't be more than 4. It can be a very wide hierarchy. So we can have cars, vans, trucks, bicycles, or something like that. You can consider sometimes, instead of using the is a relationship, which is the inheritance, the has a relationship. Sometimes you have something that consists of something else and aggregates something else together, like a stack of paper consists of individual papers. And initializer lists, they are used to initialize members and call constructors. And sometimes they are really mandatory depending on the way the constructor is written, depending on its arguments, if there are const or references, then you must use an initializer list. So I think it's good practice to use it from the beginning. And I wish you a great week and talk to you next week.